Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. Find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Tom Verton, Chief Operating Officer of Silicon Valley Bank. It is my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Paul Starobin, author of After America, and staff correspondent for the National Journal, and a contributing editor to the Atlantic Monthly. He was Moscow Bureau Chief for the Business Week from 1999 to 2003, and has written for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, the Los Angeles Times, and National Geographic. Paul has reported from Russia, Central Asia, the Caucasus, the Middle East, Europe, and South America. Previous positions include reporter from Congressional Quarterly in Washington, business reporter for the Lowell Sun in Massachusetts, and public policy case writer for John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. He grew up in Massachusetts and graduated from the Wesleyan University in Middletown, Connecticut. Starobin received a Master's of Science degree in International Relations from the London School of Economics and Political Science in 1981. Please welcome Paul Starobin.
Thank you for the introduction. It's wonderful to be here. San Francisco is one of my favorite places in the world, really. I say that honestly. I have traveled all over the world, but I love it here. I took my five-year-old son here a couple of years ago as one of his first trips with his father, and we had a tremendously good time. He's expecting me to bring back a redwood tree with him, so we'll have to see about that. So what is the book, After America, about? Let me give you first this idea of the American century. It was in 1941 that Henry Luce, who was the founder of Time Life magazine, on the eve of America's entry into the Second World War, who popularized this notion of the American century, this time when America would have a hegemony in the world. It would be a political, an economic, a military hegemony. He foresaw that going into the war, and much of his vision, I think, held true for the first 30, 40, even 50 or 60 years after that time. I'm a child of that century. I grew up in the 1950s. I was born in 1957 on an Air Force base in Bangor, Maine, where my dad was a physician. It housed the strategic bombers, so he told me. That was my world. When I graduated college, I went on to graduate school in London. That was in the early 1980s. I thought my passport was really a passport to see the world everywhere. I could travel. I went down to the Red Sea, the Sinai Desert. I slept under the stars. You know, the Bedouin camp was next to me. I imagined that no harm, you know, could come to me. I suppose it was an innocent time for me, but I think it also said something about the characteristic of that period as well. Well, the starting premise is for the book really is that that time, the American century, as Henry Luce saw it, this idea that we would be the hegemonic power, and that indeed would be a key to our happiness as a people and as a nation, that time, I think, is over. Why do I say that? I think we've reached the end of what might be called an ascendancy. It's not that we have fallen off a cliff, it's that we've been climbing this kind of long staircase, really for, you could even say, from our earliest beginnings as a republic, and we've kind of, I think we've reached just a certain end. I mean, we've gotten about as powerful as anyone can possibly get, and so there's a certain logic to, you know, that kind of an end process. Now, some have written about this post-American world. I'm thinking particularly of Fareed Zakaria in his book on that subject, as the rise of the rest. I mean, this has become probably the conventional way for talking about the post-American world, that we have China, we have India, we have a bunch of nations out there, and of course we are going to see them rise, and of course there's going to be a relative diminution of our power. I think the rise of the rest is true so far as it goes, but I don't think it goes far enough. So I think the what we have to talk about is not simply the rise of the rest, but what might be called a sagging America, a middling America, America that is essentially underperforming. Now, how are we underperforming? What are the dimensions of that? You know, I began writing this book before the global economic crisis well more than a year before that. And so that is actually not the model or the paradigm that I have in mind, although I do think it's an exhibit for how the American model, at least in terms of regulating our financial markets, has proven not to be the world's best. But while I think the crisis is a big deal, I think we also will see the economy recover from that somewhat, and that what we're really dealing with is a more deeply entrenched set of trends, structural trends that many of which go back at least until the 1970s. This is not an argument also about how George W. Bush has, destroyed the country. I mean, that's a different subject, but really the point I want to make is that I think we're talking about a more deeply set of embedded set of trends. So how to look at that? Well, let me invoke Mark Twain, who it's always a pleasure to invoke Mark Twain. He used to make fun of the Europeans. He loved to do that. He would go to Europe in the end of the 19th century, and he would say, well, where are the elevators? America had invented the elevator. The elevators were everywhere in the, Chicago skyscrapers, and he couldn't find, the Europeans for some reason at that time had really not cotton to the elevator. He said there's no market for it, it's too handy, it's too inspiring, it's too capable, it's too much of a time saver. We're just not going to do that kind of thing. We can't beguile Europe with it. In Europe, an elevator is, even to this day, is a rarity and a curiosity, especially a curiosity. And he concluded with similar remarks that were aimed at the European railway and postal services system. Well, if we were to bring Mark Twain back today and we would have him visit some of these same European landscapes, I think he would find a very different picture. Today we measure speed, for example, in terms of digital connections. I mean, how fast are we able to make those kind of connections? And if you look at that, and you look at, in fact, at the whole planet, not just Europe, but East Asia as well, America is very far behind the pack. For example, one of the standard measurements is the time it takes to download data from the internet to a personal computer device. Japan leads the world with a median download speed of 64 megabytes per second, and the ranks go down from there, from South Korea at 50, Finland 22, Sweden 17. Well, America is behind Portugal as the world's 15th fastest country at 5. The average user in Japan can download an iTunes movie in about 2 minutes. For the American user, nearly half an hour is needed. Access to broadband networks is about 4 times cheaper in Japan than in America. We like to think of ourselves as the speedy society, but in terms of at least one benchmark of modernity, of speed, then we're behind there. A second one is income inequality and mobility. I think the American ethic, if we go back to certainly the Jacksonian period of the early 19th century and beyond, was an ethic that we would have equality of opportunity. We would be an egalitarian society, not in the sense that everybody would finish the race of life at the same place, but that everyone would get a fair start. And I think that America was widely perceived as different from Europe, different from the old world in that respect. But here again, if we go back to the mid-1970s, we can see that income inequality has been widening for a number of reasons, not least the failure of America to supply all of its citizens with a first-class education, starting in primary school. A study by the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston found that since the 1970s, United States families have been significantly less likely to move up the income ladder, prompting questions that, quote, go to the heart of our identity as a nation. A 2007 study by the Pew Charitable Trust found that income mobility was actually higher in Denmark, Canada, and Finland than in America, and by some measurements, mobility higher in the United Kingdom and perhaps even in Germany, which is a model of the kind of European continental approach, has never been thought of as good of as America in those terms. So that, I think, is another benchmark of modernity where we are a laggard. Healthcare, I don't think I need to regale all of you with the statistics on healthcare. But even though we're spending, by some counts, twice as much on healthcare per capita as anyone else, we're 49th in life expectancy among the world's nations. We have the highest rate of infant mortality in the industrialized world. I was struck by a comparison between Manhattan and Paris in this regard. There's a researcher who spends a lot of his time comparing the French and the American healthcare systems. He's lived in both cities, and there are a lot of, in many ways, it's kind of a like-to-like comparison between the two cities in demographic characteristics and other characteristics. Anyway, he found that in Manhattan, there are 2.5 times as many hospital admissions for avoidable hospital conditions as there are in Paris. And that's the weakness of primary care standards in America, that we're not doing a better job in preventing the kinds of diseases that you know, ultimately might lead somebody to have to go to the hospital. And you know, there's talk that America is younger than Europe and many other countries, and that's true. But the flip side of that is that even though the Europeans are aging, if they're healthier, you know, and as they age into their 60s and their 70s, they may be able to work more productively than Americans. And if you know, work age is lengthening, so that could be an important factor. A third standard, a third benchmark of what does it mean to be modern in the 21st century is the green society. If you're not going green, then you're really going against the currents of what it means to be modern, and you're really not embracing the future. I think everyone knows that. I think everyone understands it. There's a tremendous amount of talk and discussion about it, but it's not a new issue. We had our first oil shocks in the 1970s, and since then, America has been a lot of talk, but not so much action. And look at what some of the others are doing. Denmark has been able to double the size of its economy without increasing total energy consumption. I mean, that's just a remarkable thing. And there we're basically talking about energy conservation. Germany, which you know, is not a sun-kissed country, is setting a global standard for the use of solar power to generate electricity. Its peak electricity production capacity from renewables is 4 times that of the United States. Spain gets about 9% of its electricity needs from wind. The United States, until recently, was only getting about 1%. On that front, there is probably some grounds for optimism. I was recently in Texas talking to people, and they tell me that Texas has now become one of the leading wind electricity producers in America, so perhaps we can make some strides there. But again, where have we been? You know, we're not setting the pace. You know, the Henry Luce paradigm was all about America basically being, you know, the brow of the ship that was taking, you know, the world into a new future. Innovation in manufacturing. Recent survey released by the Boston Consulting Group and the National Association of Manufacturers found the United States ranked eighth in a survey of global innovation leadership, with Singapore leading the way, followed by South Korea. According to a business executive interviewed for the survey, quote, "The United States lacks uniqueness. Innovation is now found everywhere, not exclusively or even prominently in the United States." So what does this add up to? You know, how to explain this kind of lagging performance? I think there's a bit of a paradox here, because it's often pointed out, and it's pointed out to me when I give the remarks that I've just given, that America is unsurpassed as a source of technological genius. I mean, we are not lacking in brilliant, you know, creators, and we have created many of the devices, for example, of the digital age, robotics, medical technologies, but there seems to be now a kind of missing gear that's connecting the invention to its use in the wider society, and this is what I find troubling, and in that sense, it's an indictment of the American model, because the model has never been simply about creating marvels. It's about taking the best that a democratic society can produce and making the benefits available to everyone. And this is something that we did in past times. For example, we did not actually pioneer the internal combustion engine. A lot of that work was done in Germany, but we did pioneer the motor car society at a time when that's what it really meant to be modern. And so what I see here is a kind of failure to create a standard here in America for how a 21st century modern life can be shared by all. You know, why this failure? And I, you know, I only have some possibilities here for what The reason is I haven't really settled on any one of them. One of them is that it's a function of our power, and particularly our military power, that it's difficult to be incredibly powerful and brawny, and at the same time to be really original, that maybe civilizations have to kind of make a choice in that sense, and that maybe we've become too much like Sparta and maybe not enough like Athens. I mean, that's one possibility. Another possibility has to do with scale, with the question of bigness, and maybe we've become, in some sense, too big, you know, to be as original and as efficient as we'd like to be in this kind of applied sense that I'm talking about. You know, that was actually an insight that George Kennan, the diplomat, the historian, one of the great stewards, really, of the American century, had back in the early 1990s when he was writing his memoirs. You know, Kennan had observed the crack-up of the Soviet Union, which he had predicted decades earlier, and looking at America, he said that we had become a quote-unquote monster country, one of the last left standing. I think he had India and China in that grouping as well. And what he meant, it was not so much a moral indictment, it was an indictment of our size as a kind of constraint. You know, our bureaucracy, you know, Washington not working as effectively as it should. So his suggestion actually was breaking up the country and dividing it into 10 or so decentralized republics and leaving as few functions as possible to the federal government. But the insight here that intrigues me is that perhaps there is a link between scale, between size, and what it means to be effective in the modern world. If you go back to that innovation survey, for example, it's interesting to me that among the top 8 countries, all of them are basically quite small, led by, you know, Singapore, which is really a city-state republic. The only large one in that list was South Korea. So it's something to keep in mind, whether our lack of performance perhaps has something to do with our size. And one last intangible on this, and that is that America is perhaps not as cool as it once was. And here again, there's some interesting historical perspective. I think our era of almost ultimate cool was at the end of the 19th century. You know, the Europeans had gotten over some of their, you know, their envy of us, you know, that they had earlier in the century when they regarded us as sort of comers, but also kind of raw and uncouth. By the end of, you know, by the dawn of the 20th century, it was very clear to everyone that America had arrived, and it was tremendously exciting. It was energetic. The Chicago skyscraper was a global sensation. Ragtime and then jazz music was the rage in the clubs in Paris. Even American style philosophy. William James was delivering his lectures on pragmatism. Best-selling stuff in Europe. I mean, totally against the grain of their abstract tradition and philosophy, but you know, it was working over there. It was finding an audience, and that kind of American cool continued for a long time. Certainly up through the end of the Second World War years, and even the French. You know, if you go back and read what the French were saying about the Americans at that time, they were saying we were kind of a new, improved, you know, species of mankind. So this is the sense that I have when I now make my travels is that that's really no longer the case. That you know, Obama may be cool; he's a great advertisement for us. But our kind of coolness on the organic level, on the ground of the culture itself, is not quite there. And I think, you know, if that is what is really begging the question. It's an intangible, but it's begging the question of what might be next. What might be the next cool thing. So this is really my second message in the book, that if we've reached the end of an ascendancy, that means by definition something has to come next. And I'm not attempting to make a single, you know, Las Vegas style, you know, odds-making prediction about what's going to come next. My thinking is that the world is pregnant with different possibilities, with really multiple narratives, and that indeed each of these narratives, or you could call them scenarios, has already begun, and we can kind of trace them back, and we can possibly trace them forward in a kind of speculative way. And this sense of what's next is informed by my own view of history. You know, we hear a lot about history as the product of great men, whether it's Napoleon, you know, all the way now through, you know, Reagan and Obama, that they're kind of shaping the direction. I'm more in spirit and mind with historians like Braudel, for example, of France, who emphasize the organic, the slowness of things, the tectonic layer of change that is underneath the surface. And the idea that change is constant, it's 24/7, can be a little bit deceptive. Some of these changes take a very long time to manifest themselves, and that's how I look at the ebbing and the waning of the American century. So my first scenario is a kind of dark chaos, which takes its cue from what happened after the collapse of the Roman Empire, when the barbarians took over and things got very dark indeed, at least in what we now call Europe. I mean, this is the sort of thing that could happen at the fringes, at the margins of the American, military imperium, which is overextended, which is encountering problems, everywhere where it is involved, from the tribal borderlands of Afghanistan and Pakistan to, deeper into the Middle East. And, we're kind of holding the ground, but only so. And we haven't had the kind of grand triumphs the Roman-like triumphs that the warriors of the Bush administration certainly predicted. And that suggests that our military might is sort of just not enough. You notice I didn't say that you'd reach the end of a military ascendancy. I don't think there's any doubt that America is by many times the most powerful military country in the world. But what is it getting us? So this kind of asymmetric, warfare could lead to a kind of retreat in chaotic situation. I visited, for example, Turkey as a test case of this. And we have a military base there, for example, in Anatolia that's been there since the earliest days of the Cold War. We've had a good relationship with Turkey for most of the Cold War. After the invasion of Iraq, which Turkey was really very much against, the country there really kind of turned against us. So this base sort of sits in a sea of anti-American, hostility. There were all kinds of nationalist demonstrations against the PKK Kurdish guerrilla group when I was there because we were supporting them, or we were supporting the Kurds in Iraq. And I was at rallies where my translator was telling me, take off your sunglasses, you look like a CIA agent. It was just all this kind of hatefulness, spewed at America, at Israel, at Jews, it's sort of, everything. It was just very negative. But there could be that kind of a dark chaos. I'm not saying that there will be, but it's one of the things that we have to keep in mind. Does anybody profit from dark chaos? Well, almost nobody, except maybe you could say the vultures of the world in the financial arena, for example, the short sellers, the ones who profit only when prices plummet. I suppose there are people out there who are thinking in brute survivalist terms, who've stockpiled their supplies of canned food and bottled water and antibiotics, and they will be the winners if that kind of a world arrives. Now, I wanted to flip that around a little bit. There could also be a kind of happy chaos. Those who say that America is kind of holding a finger in the dike of the world may be wrong. I mean, they said that about the British before they evacuated India. Well, it was messy, but it turned out that the world has managed to survive, thank you very much, without the British Imperium. So maybe today with technology, we have a kind of Google version of the planet. This is the one that I've heard Eric Schmidt of Google articulate, that the personal technology not only empowers us but makes the world a more peaceful place. We'll not have just our personal information devices but personal solar packs. We'll be able to travel the world as sort of happy nomads. We'll have much less of a need, much less of a demand for big government, for any kind of paternal authority. Perhaps America will be the last of the big daddies. I'm kind of skeptical about this. It's whether in theological or secular terms, I think that people have an instinct either for evil or for power at some level, perhaps, and that it's difficult for technology to cancel that out. I mean, I'd like to see things head in somewhat in that direction if it's possible, and I think that happy chaos is also one of the answers to the problems, to the problem of bigness. So happy chaos, who does that reward? That rewards those who can, people who can unbutton their collars and find their innermost merry prankster. Victory goes to those who can think and act laterally, defeat to those who can operate only in a world of hierarchies. Perhaps the patches of the planet that in the past have spawned interludes or at least ideologies of happy chaos, like Dada Zurich in Berlin after the First World War, or Grateful Dead California, the 1960s, will prove especially fertile ground for a 21st century version of this type. Perhaps happy chaos can flourish in Eastern societies like India, which have an ingrained skepticism of a world that's defined by power relations. More than anything else, winning in happy chaos will require a certain philosophical preparedness. A third scenario would be a multipolar world of nation states, and this is the conventional scenario that I think all kinds of people in Washington, from Pentagon planners to, you know, the folks at the intelligence agencies have. A lot of the think tanks also talk about this scenario. So there we see the sort of the nation state, although it's somewhat battered, surviving, and America being just a less powerful player in a world where, you know, we have India, we have China, we have Russia, we have Brazil, we have Europe, if it can keep its act together. And things might be somewhat like the 19th century, but in a 21st century kind of global world where all of the continents, you know, have their big powers. You know, I think in the short term, Russia will determine whether this multipolar world takes place because it's what they want. It's a strategic objective of Putin's Kremlin. Russia has no interest in bending to U.S.-centric global order. We've seen them willing to fight and spill blood over the issue of the former Soviet Republic of Georgia joining NATO. We're seeing it now when they're trying to push the U.S. out of its military bases in Central Asia. I think in the long run, India is a good test case for this. I visited a naval base on the Arabian Sea coast in Karwar, kind of across from the Straits of Hormuz. It's supposed to be the world's biggest naval base east of Suez. They've carved out from the rocks enclosures where they want to put their nuclear-powered submarines. And this is kind of a hard power dream of India in some ways, like what we hear about or know about China. You know, I'm not sure with India. I think they're a long way, actually, from achieving that. There are a lot of inefficiencies. This military base, for example, is still a work in progress, you know, 20 years after the project began. So who wins and who loses in a multipolar world of nation states? I think the winners are the states that can establish, let's say, regional hegemonies in the neighborhoods. The world's regional policemen might include the U.S. and North America, Brazil and South America, India and China in Asia, Russia in its so-called near abroad, perhaps Iran, if it can hold itself together in the Middle East. Europe can be a winner if it can find the will to assert itself. Otherwise, I think it'll be encroached upon by powers with more will to be powers like Russia. And the losers will be the weak and small states of the world, you know, the Georgias of the world that bank on protection against the local neighborhood bully. And the grimmest fate, as always, will be those who are essentially stateless. It'll be the Palestinians of the world. I think the multipolar world will be peaceful to the degree that the big players can arrive at satisfactory terms for coexistence. The next scenario would be the Chinese century. I mean, this is the idea that the world, as politically incorrect as this sounds, really needs an alpha dog, you know, somebody who's kind of leader of the pack, the rule maker, setting the standards that if America can no longer do this, then the only other plausible candidate is China. You know, the case for the Chinese century is usually made on brute economic terms. I mean, anybody can look at the numbers, and depending on how you analyze them, you can say that China is going to be producing the most economic output in another, you know, 20, 30, you know, 40 years. I actually don't think that's what they might get to that point, but that's not, to me, what will bring about a Chinese century. You know, they're going to have to sell a story about themselves to the world that is attractive. They're going to have their own narrative in the same way that America had the narrative that gave it what, you know, the writer Max Lerner of the 1950s called an imperialism of attraction. You know, that's how the great imperial powers succeed. And I don't think that the Chinese have that at this point, but at the same time, I wouldn't completely write them off either. You know, one of my test cases for China was a visit I made to Chile and to the copper mining region in the Atacama Desert. You know, Chile is the world's biggest producer of copper, and the Chinese have quite a large interest in copper. But what I found there was not, you know, a completely mercantile relationship. It was China engaging Chile on cultural, economic, political matters. It was China wanting to have a long-term relationship with Chile. It was the Chileans actually being being open to this relationship. You know, the Chinese are paying for Chilean kids to go to high school and learn the language in college in China. There's a lot of this kind of cultural exchange going on. They're building a Confucius Center at one of the largest universities in Chile. The Chileans have their own skepticism about America, which dates from the American support of the coup against the socialist Allende regime by Pinochet back in the 1970s. And I think everyone in Latin America, South America, sees this as a post-Monroe Doctrine world, certainly. So the Chinese, you know, they recently became the largest trading partner with Brazil, replacing America. You know, that I think Latin America will be an interesting place to see how that encounter plays out. Who wins in the Chinese century? Well, certainly China, but here maybe distance will be a blessed factor. I think Asian societies, certainly with a history of tense relations with the Chinese, including the Japanese, might be losers. I think the Pacific Coast economies of North America and South America might be winners because they're already focused on that kind of trading relationship. I think much depends, clearly, whether China is disposed to be a benign or a cruel imperial ruler. A next scenario is global city-states. This would be kind of a planetary-wide version of the Italianate city-states of the Renaissance, and it would be another response to the problem of bigness that Kennan was suggested. Whether, you know, Singapore is the model, perhaps, you know, places like Bangalore, Dubai, it doesn't have to be just the money center cities that we're familiar with, like New York and London. You know, I visited Dubai, and I found Dubai actually to be interesting. It's not just a place where, you know, criminals go to launder their money and terrorists go to have their, you know, conventions. It is that, actually. But it's not only that, and that's what makes it interesting. Harvard Medical School, for example, hopes to do well in Dubai. They are building a state-of-the-art health treatment center there, hospital complexes, research institutions. I talked to the head of Harvard in charge of this, Harvard Medical, and he said, you know what, this hospital is going to get built and it's going to be better than anything in the city of Boston, including the Massachusetts General Hospital. It's going to be a magnet for patients from all over the Middle East and maybe Eastern Europe. It's going to be a magnet for Arabs, including in America, and perhaps Arab Americans who want to practice closer to the Middle East. So I actually found that interesting. I mean, maybe there is a source of that kind of modernization that will take root in the Middle East, and maybe Dubai will be the magnet. In an age of global city-states, this offers, I think, a chance for Europe to matter again in a large way, because it's really a font of the kind of cosmopolitan values that would be ascendant in those worlds. And I think that's happening to some degree in Europe. I mean, the most interesting thing playing out in Europe to me is not really what's happening with the European Union, but it's what's happening in places like Berlin, Barcelona, Vienna, places with a lot of cultural appeal as well that are branding themselves. They're making themselves, you know, like the Italian city-states, kind of innovative places. And so far, at least, they're not fighting with each other. North Americans, South Americans, Asians are by no means dealt out. Tremendous opportunities in that world for global elites, for architects, artists, business executives, university presidents, global health specialists, all of whom tend to live in big cities already. Multilingual people will do well in this kind of a world. The last scenario is a universal civilization leading to global governance. This is essentially one world, one market, one system of regulation for everything from finance to greenhouse gases. You know, maybe the global economic crisis gets us there. You know, George Soros, I think, has been hoping for a long time that there would be a global financial sheriff. Maybe it's the reality of global climate change. Maybe it's, you know, this notion of universal jurisdiction for human rights, war crimes. You know, I would point out that there is a certain former vice president of the United States who I think right now is a very careful planner of his travel itinerary with respect to visiting certain European countries. I think America gets to play in this world. I think our universities, Harvard is basically become a global university. I don't particularly think of it as an American university. At the Harvard Business Review, they don't allow their writers to use American baseball metaphors because, you know, that's not part of the global, you know, vocabulary. Their readers might not understand them. I think of Hollywood as becoming a global institution. Now, it's not just a manufacturer of American dreams, but of multicultural dreams. So the winners, again, I think, are the global superclass. I think the winners in a global society like that are the multinational corporations. In fact, I think they hope in some level that this will happen because they have the deep resources, the deep pockets to play at that level, and they'll be able to shape the system to their interest. You know, the global governance would be a victory for bigness, and it would suggest that small is really not the wave of the future, that there are some trends that require these really enormous institutions to deal with them. It'll be a victory for sure for bureaucracy as well. And you know, lastly, you know, there's a chapter in the book about California, which I think, as always, represents a kind of future in America. And in this case, I think California represents a sort of after America world that's already in the making. There's an element of dark chaos in California. We can certainly see that in the state's fiscal condition. There's a template for happy chaos. I mean, I guess I'm in the city that generated the Craigslist group, which allows people to pursue their own connections, perhaps not always happily, but certainly without any big brother guidance. There's the nation state, California. You know, we have the governor, you know, negotiating at one point with the prime minister of Britain on greenhouse gases. I mean, there's that kind of national type consciousness. There's Pacific Rim, California, that's looking to China and East Asia for so much of its economic activity. There's city-state China. I recently wrote in the Wall Street Journal that maybe California should be chopped into three pieces, where we'd have, you could sort of define it by its different city-states, and they could pursue their own connections. You know, think of California as the British Isles. If there can be independence for Scotland, then why not for the Bay Area? And then there's global California. There's, you know, Stanford is a global institution, Hollywood, as mentioned. So the last takeaway here really is that Americans should think about this stuff. I mean, it's not a gloomy message. I understand it can be perceived that way, but it's really a message of realism. I mean, what I worry about is that the political culture will become transfixed by what has been and by nostalgia. I mean, we know from history that nostalgia can become a really dangerous thing for empires in their last days. It was so for the British when they had that ill-fated invasion of the Suez Canal in the 1950s, and Eisenhower had to call them off. So we hope that those kinds of things are not going to happen. I also think Americans should be thinking, you know, in terms of their own communities and how they can respond to these trends, because I think that Washington, the political class where I live, is going to be the last to really acknowledge these realities. I think much of the political class is still in denial. I think education has a lot to do with it, and it's not just math and science, but language. I mean, for me, language is the gateway to culture. You know, I live not so far from an elementary school that's a French immersion school in McLean, Virginia. Every door, every sign is in French for the kids. I mean, why not do more of that? If Obama wants to spend $1 trillion or so reviving the economy, maybe some of that can be for more sort of cultural training and awareness. And learning from other societies. I mean, let's do a kind of reverse Tocqueville and send out citizen experts all over the world. You know, go to Japan and see what they're doing with high-speed rail. See how Estonia has become a premier, you know, wired nation. And, you know, come back here to America and kind of inform us about what's happening. So that's my last takeaway. Thank you. You've been good listeners, and I'm happy to field any of your questions.
Our thanks to Paul Starobin for his comments today. My name's Joe Epstein. I'm a past president and a current member of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors. I'm going to be conducting the question and answer portion of this program. Paul, you just mentioned the nostalgic word as being something which could be in concert with the decline, possibly, of the United States. You said it was not a positive emotion to have. I had an emotion when I first read the book and picked it up, and I realized the thesis, and it was sort of a resistance to the fact that, you know, what do you mean? What is he saying that the United States is on the decline? And I kind of wanted to ask you if you've had that sense at all through your book tour, people resisting that idea, not coming to grips with your academic approach to this thesis?
Mm-hmm. Not as much as I expected, actually. I was recently speaking at the Dallas Petroleum Club, which on this, and I, which I thought was kind of like a visit to the lion's den, you know, the heart of American exceptionalism and all of that. But actually, I found people afterwards coming up to me and say, well, you know, you really should have said this about the educational system or that about the healthcare system. You know, education in particular, I find that I haven't met anyone who doesn't think that our educational system today is a lot worse. I mean, you know, significantly worse than it was, you know, 20 or 30 or 40 years ago. So I actually find the most resistance to this comes more in Washington, where it's not so much active resistance, it's just denial.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd like to revert to sort of a chronology, if you will, in the first part of your book, 10-20% of it, quite a bit of it, actually. You compare America's rise and fall from power with other empires throughout the history. You give lots of historical data and reasoning. Could you kind of, as quickly as you can, go through some of those main backdrop of other empires, other nations, and how that impacts your thesis here?
I think the closest parallel would be the British because, you know, we inherited, of course, a lot of our basic ideas and our political philosophy from the British, and in some ways, the British handed off to us when they no longer able to do the job, with the difference being that we were not a formal colonial power in the same way that the British were. But I think there's a similarity in the sense that, you know, empires are not only about power and profits. I mean, that's often what they're mostly about, but they're also about their pursuit of values. And, you know, even for me, you know, empire is, I suppose it has a negative connotation, but, you know, sometimes it's just the way of the world. I think the British thought that they were doing good everywhere they went. And, you know, and sometimes I meet people when I travel around the world who say, you know, like in Africa, for example, I was recently talking to a fellow from Ghana who said, you know, thank God we had the British as our colonialists and not the French, because, you know, the French propped up all these nasty dictators in Africa, and then the British actually built a decent infrastructure. So I actually think by historical standards, the Americans have been incredibly benign, you know, as an imperial ruler, and one of the reasons, you know, that we succeeded during the Cold War was because the Soviet Union, I think, was, you know, transparently a much more cruel and malevolent, you know, imperialist. But nevertheless, you know, the imperialism of attraction is still imperialism. And at some point, you know, others in the world just sort of, you know, scratch their heads and say, well, okay, we've done that for a while, and maybe there's, you know, there's a different way to do it. Mm-hmm. And I suppose the Roman example is there, but, you know, I wouldn't want to push that too much because it really, you know, it was a long time ago. Maybe in the military dimension, maybe that's where the parallel is. That the Roman Empire fell despite being, you know, the world's supreme military power, right? So the military doesn't get you everything that you might think it can get.
Yeah, and in that vein, there's been quite a few questions submitted about the military. Here's one I'd like to ask, and it has to do with privatization, or I guess I would call it the use of contractors.
Mm-hmm.
What role has rampant privatization of former U.S. military functions played in the hastening of the American hegemony's twilight?
Yeah, a friend and a colleague of mine, Cullen Murphy, who used to be the editor of the Atlantic Monthly, he's now at Vanity Fair, wrote an interesting book that dealt with those themes called Are We Rome? And I think, you know, in the parallel there was basically where we have hirelings who essentially do a lot of these jobs, and I think it encourages a certain degree of cynicism about, you know, the military in the sense that, you know, we all support the troops, but, you know, the military in America has become a kind of subculture of its own, and, you know, not that many Americans sort of outside of the military really have all that much to do with it. I mean, to me, an interesting what if is what if we had stuck with the draft, with conscription, and we didn't end the draft, you know, essentially for political reasons, you know, and during the Vietnam War, would we be as engaged abroad if we were fighting with a, you know, if we had a draft, you know, and if we weren't paying these contractors, in some cases, you know, pretty spectacular sums of money to do the job? I mean, I tend to think it would be a political check on some of the things that we've done.
But my sense of the contractors is that they really weren't performing pure military functions in terms of fighting, that it was...
Not fighting, no.
Not fighting, right.
That's true, but I mean, I think there's a kind of a synergy there. I mean, they certainly in Iraq, you know, when, after the invasion, they were, as a kind of private security force, they fought when fired upon. So, you know, they were engaged, and a lot of them are former, you know, special operations people and stuff like that. I mean, you know, this is a large world that we're talking about, the world of the contractors. They do all kinds of things.
Well, I think there's a good segue here to torture in terms of the afterworld, if you will, of America and mm-hmm. its perception. Torture as a departure of traditional American values. It's not clear, for example, if waterboarding is considered torture, but it is clear that the U.S. did waterboard many terrorist suspects being mm-hmm. held in our prisons. So do you think the act of waterboarding, as an example, has caused some in the international community to feel that U.S. leadership has slipped and our prestige has been eroded because our moral leadership is now in question?
You know, I think that waterboarding is part of a narrative that foreigners have when they look at us and they see what's happened to, you know, America, and particularly in the military dimension, and they see us, you know, slipping away from some of the values that we have ourselves, you know, espoused and generally honored over the years. So I think in that sense, the answer is basically yes.
Mm-hmm. Another question from the audience: at what point was America's decline or the end of its ascendancy inevitable, in your view?
Inevitable is a forbidding word. I think it was, I begin the book with a prologue, which is August 1991, Moscow, and the Soviet Union was collapsing. It only had days, or I suppose months, you could say, left. And the KGB coup had failed, and the demonstrators had moved on to the statue of Felix Dzerzhinsky, the original leader of the Cheka, the Soviet secret police in Moscow, where I lived and worked for 4 years. And they pulled down the statue, and there was tremendous excitement. There was fireworks in the sky. You know, it was accompanied by encomiums to Bush, the first Bush. There was a sense that a kind of moment had been reached, an apogee, that America was very much implicated in a good way. I would say that was the ascendancy. And when, you know, we saw the decline, I don't think any one kind of moment, if you want to look at foreign affairs, I suppose you could talk about what was happening in the Balkans, you know, the kind of generalized collapse of the new world order that, you know, that the first President Bush had proclaimed, and, you know, and we began to see that America was, you know, was still very powerful, but it was not going to be kind of master of this dominion, perhaps as people had expected after the Soviet Union collapsed.
Many people want to know who's next in line, and you've touched on that.
Right. Yeah,
China.
Who's next? Yeah.
India,
yeah.
A possibility.
Yeah.
And I read about something called the BRIC countries.
The BRICS, yep.
Brazil, Russia, India, and China combined,
yep.
They generate currently approximately 20% of the world's economic growth, not too far behind, I think, where the United States is now.
Yeah. Well, the BRICS is a concept that was developed by some ingenious analyst at Goldman Sachs, and that's how it began. I mean, I guess they needed, I don't mean to be flip about it, but, you know, they had it's a good acronym, you know, because it could spell BRIC, you know, I think Brazil, yes. I was recently in Brazil. I think that there's a lot of interesting things happening in Brazil. Definitely a rising middle class. Not much hard power in Brazil, but, you know, interesting soft power. They're doing a lot of interesting things with multinational companies. Russia, my old stomping ground. I don't actually see great things coming out of Russia. I mean, the population is dying in Russia. It's really sad. They're having to pay women to have babies, you know, which is really not a very a workable strategy. You know, Putin has decentralized things way too much in the Kremlin. You know, it's sort of becoming a failed society in a surviving state. India and China, certainly, you know, India and China that'll be one of the great races that we'll see in the 21st century. I completely buy that. I'm not sure who comes out ahead. But both of those societies, I think, you know, are certainly part of what we call the, you know, or what Fareed Zakaria called the rise of the rest.
Right. Well, just take a quick break here. You are listening to the Commonwealth Club of California's radio program. We're talking with Paul Starobin, author of After America, Narratives for the Next Global Age. My name is Joe Epstein. The United Nations, let's just briefly touch on them, because they're going to play a role depending on who, if anyone, takes over the supremacy globally of the United States. So here's a question from the audience on the assumption that it will be China. In a multipolar world, China-dominated world future, what do you see the role of the United Nations to be in supporting the less powerful developing countries? Or how effective do you believe the United Nations can be?
In a China-dominated world, my guess is not that effective. I'm not sure that the Chinese would see that as an organization that would necessarily serve their broader interests. But they might tolerate it. I think the United Nations in general is plagued by a lot of effectiveness problems, and so it's not really even my choice of the institution that would necessarily lead us into a global society. It has a lot of problems, and it's really been resistant to reforms. I mean, they haven't even been able to change the numbers, the permanent Security Council members since the inception of the organization, even though the world has already changed a lot since the Dumbarton Oaks Conference when they created the UN.
So you have a belief that you write about in your book about the preparedness of blue America. You don't really talk so much about red America. You
right.
talk about blue America.
Well.
So why do you feel that blue America is further along than red America in adopting to our diminishing global clout?
I think red America has bought more into the myth of American exceptionalism and in some cases has tied that myth to this notion of, it's not just that God blesses America, but that God chooses America in some fashion, and that if you think that way, I think it is mythical. You're going to be ripe for the kind of nostalgia disease that I'm talking about. I think Blue America is at this point anyway is more cosmopolitan. I think it's more flexible. I think it's looking more towards Europe and others for interesting ideas. It's more green friendly. Civil rights. I mean, the issues like same-sex marriage, for example, which have gone a lot further in Europe. I see that as part of the brow of the ship of the future. The Blue America is much more accepting of that as well. And Blue America is winning. I mean, Blue America is winning. It's look at Red America. It's becoming a regional thing. I mean, it exists in the Confederacy. The old Confederacy of the South. You have, Senator Arlen Specter in Pennsylvania is now part of Blue America. I mean, so, how do they win in these circumstances? That would be, I think, in an after America world, it could get so bad that the Red America may cease to exist as a kind of effective political party.
Mm-hmm. Interesting thesis. I enjoyed reading about that, and I'm glad you answered. Thank you. Back to the military for a moment. And let's talk about America's coalition in Iraq. The Bush administration was very proud of the coalition. The president talked about it a lot.
Mm-hmm.
However, it was very small and very limited.
Right.
Is this an example of a waning American prestige, or just an example of maybe a poor choice of a country to invade? without broad international support?
Both. Well, of course it's an example of our prestige. I think just objectively speaking, if we can't get, other players besides the Brits to go along with us, the Australians, there were some others here, but not, like you say, not in large numbers. No, I mean, nobody can argue with that. Poor choice. I mean, that's an interesting way to phrase the question. I'm not sure how history decides, why did we invade Iraq? I mean, I'm not sure I really know the answer to that. Maybe, because we could. I mean, it never made any sense to me at the time, and I'm still trying to figure it out.
Well, let's shift gears for a moment to a very, very current event, which is the elections in Iran. Mm. What is the significance of the recent elections in Iran? And let's also bring in Lebanon, because they seem to be similar but also different, if that makes sense. Relative to where international relations in the United States are headed, and let me put a postscript on this. President Obama is dealing now with this election, and he's walking in Iran, and he's walking a very tight line.
He is. So
can you also grade our president in how he's handling this in terms of our prestige?
Well, you know, the foreign correspondent in me is going to be a little bit cautious here because I'm not in Iran, and you know, I think we have limited information, and I'm not sure how the balance of power is shifting or not shifting in Iran. I think Obama's playing it quite well. I think he's extraordinarily, you know, agile, or at least is showing himself to be in these kinds of cases. He chooses his language very carefully, which I think is a good thing. He seems to think before he says something. So I think he understands the delicacy in the sense that if he says too much about what the United States would like to see in terms of an outcome, then it risks America becoming the issue in Iran itself, and so there could be a backlash. So, you know, I'm not really sure exactly what we can do. I mean, my guess is if I were there and I were a journalist on the ground, I would imagine that America is involved in some level talking to these different actors, and I would be fascinated to know what is the real level that we're the real role that we're playing right now, because I'm sure there's a very interesting story there.
Right, and I'm not sure the president has addressed the recent election in Lebanon.
Lebanon, yeah.
But do you have an opinion on what's going on there?
No great wisdoms. I think Lebanon is also one of these places where the balance can swing. And, you know, I think Iran and Hezbollah may have overplayed their hand. I don't think there's a huge and enormous appetite for Lebanon. You know, the elections seem to show that they would want it to tip in that direction. Obama probably gets some points in the sense that he made, you know, the speech in Cairo. He kind of went over the heads of the governments in the Middle East and the wider Islamic lands, and he said a lot of the right things. I think that maybe there's an outcome in Lebanon that is, you know, more American, you know, friendly than we might have thought. But again, I mean, we see how quickly things can change in this region.
So on this next question, please don't think I'm asking for a yes or no answer, although it may sound like it. You touched on this in your presentation tonight. Is America's decline, if you will, to be thought of in terms of the actual decline of the country and our policies and our prestige, or is it more or as much because there's a natural rise of the rest of the world, other parts of the world?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think a lot about that. I think it is both. I guess I would probably say kind of a half and half in terms of, you know, I mean, and the two, of course, are linked. I mean, if there's a sort of deterioration of America in terms of things like our educational standards and our health care and so forth, and then, you know, you're going to see other societies, you know, organizing around different principles, and they will begin perhaps this rise. The reason I like to focus on you know, let's say the decline element of it is not to kind of, you know, batter the issue, but because it's the part of it that Americans can control. You know, the rise of the rest, that's sort of like watching the cakes bake in the oven, and they're just going to bake or not bake, or, you know, maybe it's a souffle and it collapses, but I'll block that metaphor. The control, but you know, what's happening here in America, I mean, you know, there are things we can do about our educational system, our healthcare system, you know, our becoming a green society. So let's just, you know, address it from that vantage point.
Again, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California's radio program, and we're talking with Paul Starobin, author of After America, Narratives for the Next Global Age. I'm Joe Epstein. So are you saying in this book that America is actually toast?
I think I'm saying it's more like stale bread. No, we're not toast. I mean, no, of course we're not toast, but we've got a lot of work to do.
And again, another question back to President Obama. Doesn't the new age of Obama promise to renew America and America as a positive example to the world?
To some degree. I mean, I think so far Obama's been pretty successful. At the same time, I think there are limits. I think we're going to see the end of the charm offensive. For example, he's going to be visiting Russia in early July, and I've looked at polling on how Russians are feeling about Obama, and not so positively. I mean, it's not that they don't particularly like Obama, but, you know, as popular as any single global leader can be, you know, I think there's a sense, I mean, people are sophisticated about this. They understand that, you know, he's the president, but, you know, he comes from the society. I mean, there are all these institutions. I mean, those who kind of apprehend America as a kind of empire, I mean, they understand that Obama is going to be kind of, you know, captive to some of that as well. So I think there are limits to what even, you know, a kind of magician like Obama can do with his talents.
A few questions about the current economic crisis. What effect to U.S. world leadership has the global economic crisis had? Hasn't our recovery, such as it is, at least we're told we're under recovery or starting one, which happens to be far ahead of Europe and other major countries, hasn't this recovery been proof of our economic leadership?
No. First of all, I think the premise is wrong. There are lots of places around the world that have been doing fairly well, or at least a lot better than we have during the crisis. And you know, India is one, and Brazil is another. They haven't experienced anything like what we've experienced. You know, China is a more interesting case. I mean, I'm not there, but there's clearly been some social strain and stress in China. At the same time, the Chinese have, you know, their trillions in reserves, and they're using it to buy on the cheap, you know, assets all around the world. So the Chinese may, in fact, come out in an improved position from the crisis. I don't think that anyone, including the Americans, think that their model has shown itself to be working well during this crisis, which is why we're kind of reinventing everything. I don't think anyone thinks that the nationalization of the General Motors company is a sign of the model working. It's at best a political and economic, you know, kind of desperation move, and if anything, it's a sense that we're doing some of the same things that the Europeans, particularly on the continent, have been doing to their economy for the last 100 or so years. We're becoming more like the French or the Germans. It's certainly not the traditional Anglo-American laissez-faire style of capitalism. I think that model has been badly battered.
Well, we'd like to finish off here with a few questions, a few personal questions. Before we came on for tonight's program, we were talking about some of the experiences and the emotionality of writing a book. As you were writing this book, what was the most surprising thing that you learned?
I didn't initially have in my proposal a chapter on city-states, and it was a pleasant surprise for me. I don't know so much to learn, but kind of to be exposed to a whole vein of thinking and literature and conversation about how cities and city-states could be a wave of the future. I probably had a more conventional kind of geopolitical model of how things might change, and so that was something that kind of came to me over my research and my travels.
Right. And what made you interested in the first place to write a book of this magnitude?
Well, you know, I had reached the ripe old age of 50 years old or so, and I had never written a book, and I felt like, there was a need for me to stretch in some way. But, you know, of course, I didn't want to write a book just for the sake of writing a book. I think the seed was probably when I spent 4 years in Moscow as a foreign correspondent. I was there from 1999 to 2003, and I had spent, you know, previously most of my career and time in Washington. And so, you know, having a distance, having a vantage point, having a perspective, you know, being out of the country, you get to sort of see your native country in kind of a different way, and that's probably what led me to it as much as anything else.
And then the obvious last question would be, so you traveled a great deal to a lot of places, met with a lot of people. What were your most revealing and your most interesting interviews?
Well, I remember having an interview with now president of Russia, Dmitry Medvedev, in the Kremlin, and he was drawing diagrams for me about how things worked in Russia, and I was asking him about the, you know, kind of the Anglo-American system of checks and balances. He said, no. So he drew something, it's like kind of a napkin, I wish I had saved it. It was all about how, you know, one point of the triangle is the Russian business elite, at another point of the triangle is the sort of the intelligentsia, you know, the political class and other. We're all kind of in harmony, you know, together. And I was thinking, boy, you know, this is not something that I'm gonna get from anyone else. I was interested, you know, I interviewed the head of Sony Pictures in Hollywood, Michael Linton, and somewhat to my surprise, I mean, you asked about resistance to the thesis. He was on it faster than I was when I talked about the decline of the American, you know, in terms of the cultural hegemony. It was like, oh, you know, sure, you know, we've been thinking about that a long time at Sony Pictures, and, you know, we're investing in Russia, we're investing in India. We're, you know, our thing isn't, you know, this is no longer Frank Capra's, you know, America, you know, Hollywood. I mean, this is a, you know, we're interested in global things. And, you know, it kind of hit me that Hollywood has really not been sold out to the left, as the cultural left, as it's often said. It's basically become, you know, it's just become absorbed by you know, global multinational capitalism.
Well, it seems like we all have our work cut out for us if we're going to do our best to keep America on top. Our thanks to Paul Starobin, staff correspondent for National Journal and author of After America. We also thank our audiences here and on the radio. My name's Joe Epstein. And now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned. Thank you all for coming.